In order to put on record as to the eminent guest we have today in our, among ourselves is Her Excellency Judge Dr. Neeru Chadha. She's an alumni from Law Faculty, Delhi University, and we are very privileged to have her with us today. And I would expect that you would have certain questions for me. It's a very proud privilege to be, to have known her from our LLB days together. And the unassuming nature is something which we all feminists talk about, you know, breaking hierarchies. And she's epitome of that. She's never thrown her weight around having achieved such heights. And she is the first woman from India. If you remember the headlines 3 years ago, which were saying that she is the second woman in India after Vijayalakshmi Pandit to have reached such a high position in UN. And certainly she is the first Indian woman to be a judge of ICLOS. And as I mentioned earlier, she is also the first woman agent of representing India in the international proceedings. She was heading the treaties and legal and treaties division. That's what it's called? Legal and treaties division of Government of India.
Ministry of External Affairs.
And she has risen from the ranks of you.
The students are in front of us today, and I thought it would be very, very
motivational and enlightening to have a little conversation with her today. So here's is Dr. Neeru Chadha.
Thank you very much, and hello once again. So I was about to tell you about the International Tribunal for Law of the Sea. You all must be aware that there is a convention called United Nations Convention on Law of the Sea, which deals with various issues relating to law of the sea. Of great concern for us, for any state, is delimitation or marking of its maritime zones, because under each maritime zone, which is territorial sea, economic zone, or high seas, states have different rights. So if you have been following up on matters with our neighbors, you must be remembering, though you may be in early years of college at that time, in 2012, we did have a case with Bangladesh, where our case went to one of the international tribunals for delimitation of our maritime boundary with Bangladesh. So Law of the Sea handles various issues, so it's not possible for me to outline to you in such a short period everything. Basically, it's rights of the states in various zones, territorial sea, economic zone, high seas. And also, sea is one of the major transit route for 80% of world trade. So Law of the Sea, in that sense, is very important. Also, it's a source of food for, I think, 23% of the world population relies on fish for its food. So taken together, sea is a great source for not only food but also economic activity. So Law of the Sea also, because it deals with so many issues, it also has dispute settlement mechanisms. These are the disputes which arise between states who are parties to the United Nations Law of the Sea Convention. And there are four mechanisms provided under the Law of the Sea Convention itself for dispute settlement. One is our tribunal. The second is the International Court of Justice. Third is something called Annex 7 tribunals. Annex 7 is one of the chapters of the Law of the Sea Convention, which provides for setting up of ad hoc tribunals. And the fourth is the Annex 8 tribunals, which deal with certain kind of environment-related disputes. So International Tribunal for Law of the Sea is one of the mechanisms which the states can choose for settlement of their disputes relating to interpretation and application of Law of the Sea Convention. So that's basically very broadly our role for settlement of disputes between states relating to interpretation and application of Law of the Sea Convention. Apart from delimitation of maritime zones, there are disputes relating to, arrest of ships, and there can be disputes relating to seabed. So I think you all are LLB students. So you, if you have not read Law of the Sea, the terms which I am telling you must be news to you, but maybe someday I'll take a class on Law of the Sea with you people. But it's one of the conventions. It plays an important role for peaceful settlement of disputes. So since you have not been exposed to what Law of the Sea entails, it's, I think, not very useful for me to go into details because your class deals with gender justice. So I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, so the two things I'll add, I think ITLOS has got jurisdiction over 167 countries.
167
countries are subject of their jurisdiction. So you can imagine that the Supreme Court of India, you can have a sense that they have jurisdiction over India, people in India. Their tribunal has jurisdiction over 167 countries. But the other thing I think which connects her, Neeru, to our class is she had her LLM dissertation on economic independence as a step towards equality.
That's my PhD.
Sorry, not LLM, PhD, the thesis on that. And therefore, she has always, constantly been thinking on these terms as well. Of course, today we are not focusing only on women. Today's class is much more focused on identities of the third as well. Mm-hmm. So if you have a quick question, you can ask her. Otherwise, she will perhaps jump in when we talk about the third. She would have certain insights or questions or clarification and observations on that aspect as well. So do you have anybody has any question to ask her?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, who wants to start, Ria?
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, ma'am. I'm Ria. I had a simple question. How was your time at law faculty? And
and
that's
well, it. We'll add the other second question.
Well, I think the foundation for my career was laid in the law faculty. So I remember my days in the law faculty with great fondness, because it not only prepared me for my future role as a legal advisor in the Ministry of External Affairs and thereafter, it also gave me some excellent friends. I mean, we have been friends since last
40 years.
So I owe a lot to the law faculty. And of course, I remember with great fondness the great teachers we had, Professor Latika Sarkar, Professor Vendra Bakshi, Professor Dian Singh, Professor Rotagi. So I think we were really very lucky to have been taught by such greats. And of course, I remember the law faculty Chaiwala, I think, who's still there.
And even today, when she comes to the faculty,
he offers her free tea.
He remembers me after 40 years. That's a lot. So otherwise, yeah, we had some great teachers and great times in the law faculty. And I hope you are having the same. You have such great eminent teachers like Professor Ved Kumari.
You know, you see all these ZX prefixes. These are all students who are not in my section.
Okay.
And so my section is actually 50% of the total class.
Great. Because you are privileged to have Professor Ved Kumari as your teacher.
The students with whom I'm actually the teacher, they're not joining. Students for whom I'm not the teacher,
they're joining. That's great.
Who was the other one who wanted to ask? I didn't catch the name.
Ma'am Ramesh.
Yes, Ramesh.
Ma'am, I'd like to ask ma'am a specific question, ma'am. Can you able to guide us, ma'am, how to make a career in the law of sea? Because law of space and law of sea is a new type dimension of career coming up in the society. So in this light, can you slightly guide us how we can make our career also in this field?
I think one of the Law of the Sea in itself is a very limiting career, because in our area, the disputes are basically, disputes which arise between states, we handle those. But if you go into international maritime law as such, that's a much wider area, because it deals with shipping and all the laws relating to shipping. So I think if you opt for international maritime law, that's a much, much broader area. And of course, with so much of shipping going on, I think that can provide a good opportunity for lawyers to practice in international maritime law. For that, I think, I don't know whether we provide in LLM any
space and
law of the sea. But then you can also look for some diploma courses in international maritime law. You can check in Institute of International Law, or there are certain specific international maritime law institutes which offer such courses, just to make you aware about what the international maritime law entails. And then you can choose if you want to go further into studies or, you know, practice in that area. So I think mostly you would have to have exposure in international maritime law. So that would be useful if you want to pursue a career in the law of the sea or international maritime law.
Ma'am, one more question, ma'am, I would like to ask. Ma'am, for making a career, we should have an LLM also in this field only, law of maritime. Because law of maritime has been introduced in our second semester in international law. And I know a little bit about that and about the current scenario which is happening in India, because some of the companies in India are taking some stakes in Sri Lankan coastal region for building up there, because it is the interest of India for bringing some revenue to India.
Okay.
So these type of cases, because sometimes of dispute which happen with respect to China, because China is also interested in taking their stakes in their coastal region development.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
These type of cases comes up to the ICJ and then it's get decided there, but we don't know the procedure exactly what is happening out there, because in India we don't have a right type of guidance. I mean to say that, because I am still doing LLB, so just I'm reading the things on newspaper and just coming up with this idea. So as you are practicing, ma'am, so you are knowing much better than us, so let us guide us, ma'am.
Like within India, I think within Delhi I can talk, because in Bombay, etc., where there are, you know, I think there are some firms which handle international maritime law areas, because within Delhi, I'm not aware whether there are any firms which are handling that. But of course, you know, subject domain knowledge definitely helps. And I think I can do a talk with you and tell you of specific opportunities where, you know, students who are interested in going further into this area, which are the institutions they can approach for higher. I think LLM always helps, because, you know, generally in LLM you get an opportunity to go deeper into a subject. So then you can also at that time, you know, realize whether your interest lies in this subject or not. And also there are specialized institutes like IMLI in Malta, which offers, you know, post-graduation courses to students in international maritime law. So I can, get more details on that and pass on to your professor, and she can pass on the name of those institutes to you. Since I'm not, I was not aware that I'm going to speak to you people, so I'm not, you know, I don't have all the names of institutes which offer courses in international maritime law, because my expertise basically was built up during my stint with Ministry of External Affairs. You know, I did my LLM and PhD in Delhi University, but I practiced international law in Ministry of External Affairs. I worked in Legal and Treaties Division, which handles international law issues for government of India for almost 25 years. So my expertise was built, you know, by practical training as my role as a legal advisor in Ministry of External Affairs. But definitely these days, many more opportunities outside the government are available. And there are specialized institutes which deal with these kind of courses. So I can do a short talk with you later on sometime. We can fix up and apprise you of, you know, specific names of the institutes it will be useful for you if you want to pursue a career in international maritime law.
You know, before she was in the legal entities division, we did not know what this division actually did. And then I learned that every single document, every single agreement which India signs at international level goes through this ministry, through this department. Unless they vet it and approve it, it doesn't move further. So therefore, when she was in India, working in the department, she was exposed not only to law of the seas, but every single area of international law. Because India does the treaties and agreements in all spheres. So 25 years, she was dealing all over international law.
Yeah,
it's only now that she has kind of focused on law of the sea. So certainly, any international law aspect, she has on her fingertips because of the experience, and what she said is practical to anything she did. And she was kind of advising at a very high level. We are at a very base level of just understanding. So she is,
I'm not equipped to teach.
We keep on telling you that she used to teach her courses, so I'm not a teacher.
I'll answer. So that's where we are still building up the possibilities of her offering
some. You ask me a question, I can give you an answer, but I don't know how to, frame a lecture like your professors do.
Okay, we're ready. I'll announce a proper meeting timing, independent of our class timings.
Yeah, those of you who are interested in knowing.
Yeah, we'll make it open for all students in all the three centers. So we'll hold a proper seminar on that aspect. Coming back to gender identities.
Yeah, you're ready? I didn't see your mail today. I did see that you have sent a mail, but I have not read what you have written.
Oh, I just wrote that. I'll take 10 minutes.
Okay, great. Start.
Okay, just a second. I'll share my screen. Is the presentation visible?
Getting, yes. It's visible.
Is it? Okay. So I'll start. So this is a part of our reading material, which is the introduction to a book by Rajesh Talwar, The Third Sex. He discusses a lot of aspects to the trans identity. And what he does is he compares transsexuals of the West to the hijras of South Asia. Also, I would like to add a disclaimer that I haven't read very intensely about all these things. So if anyone has anything to add or correct me, then please do. So he discussed these terms, transsexuals of the West, hijras of South Asia. And what he does is he identifies two misconceptions about these people and discusses them further. We will also discuss sex and gender, the differences and the other things thereof, and we will do a comparative study of sorts between these two identities. So transsexuals. So in this peach box, you might read that internal and external bodily features of one sex. So what these people feel is that they do have internal and external bodily features of one sex, but they also have a strong desire to change that. And this strong desire can take the form of getting a sex reassignment surgery, or which is highly prevalent. So what a sex reassignment surgery does is you get to change your sexual organs through surgical intervention. But he also, what he does is he compares two different identities, transvestites and homosexuals, with transsexuals. So he defines transvestites as people who dress, who are from a particular sex but would like to perform the opposite gender by dressing up differently, etc. And this scholar Robert Wintermute, he tries to emphasize that transsexuals is not related to sexuality at all. It is related to your gender performance and how you feel about that particular gender identity. If you look at to the right, I've added four pictures. Do you want me to use the term kinnar? Okay, I would like to agree with that. I don't particularly understand why. However, in this reading, he's used the term Hijra, so that's why I'm using the term. But yes, I would change that. So if you look to the right, there are four photos. RuPaul's gathering.
If I may intervene, Kinnar is not equivalent to transgender. This is a particular group among Hijra themselves, they use it. And therefore, you cannot substitute Kinnar for transsexual or transgender persons.
So, if you see on the right, I've used four photos. Has anyone seen RuPaul's Drag Race?
No.
Or has anyone seen ContraPoints? She's a YouTuber. And the bottom two is J.K. Rowling and Jermaine Greer. So yes, RuPaul's Drag Race is a show on which you can dress as a drag queen. Usually, it's men dressed as women. Correct me if I'm wrong. And ContraPoints is a transgender YouTuber who recently came out as a lesbian. So I will give you a link to that if you want. But what I want to emphasize is it is not related to sexuality at all. ContraPoints recently came out as a lesbian, so you will not be, they will not conform to heteronormativity as a rule. Also, what do feminists think? How do feminists react to this transsexualism, etc.? So there's a particular term, TERF, which is trans-exclusionary radical feminists. And a prime example of that recently has become J.K. Rowling. Really, unfortunately, all of us grew to be Harry Potter fans. And she recently has been writing a lot of turfy things on Twitter. And her most controversial view is that trans women are not women and should be excluded from the feminist struggle. And Jermaine Greer, of course, is a prime example. A lot of feminists see it as an attack on their values and an attack on what they fought for, which I personally disagree from. And then he comes to hijras. So what he does is he says hermaphrodites, eunuchs, intersex, and those who have undergone emasculation constitute hijras of South Asia. So hermaphrodites is people who have both testes and ovaries. Eunuchs is castrated males, and intersex people are someone with ambiguous sexual organs. Hermaphrodites and intersex people are kind of similar. But although it includes all these three broad categories, All India Hijra Welfare Association asserted that 90% of hijras are castrated men. Also, then he talks about two major misconceptions that is associated with the Hijra community. First is forcible taking away of hermaphrodite children. Has anyone read Arundhati Roy's book, The Ministry of Utmost Happiness?
Yes.
Do you remember how what happened to the intersex child? And if you could tell the class in a minute. Nidhi.
If I remember correctly, the child ran away from their home and joined this place where this child felt like they were accepted. And in their home, this person was not thrown out of the house, but never accepted in their own home.
Yeah.
So I read it a while ago.
So one of the major misconceptions that is associated with the Hijra community is that they prey on intersex or hermaphrodite children. They take them away to be a part of their own groups. But two particular scholars, Ananda and Sharma, they talk about that they're only isolated incidents. And the only actual incident they found to be true was from decades ago. And also Section 361 of the IPC criminalizes such acts, that you can't actually take away children to make them do anything, kidnapping, etc. So, and the second misconception that Rajesh Talwar talks about is post-castration. Also, when you talk about this taking away children thing, we've never actually seen children with Hijra communities during their performances or any time else. So why would someone make a kidnap children for 10 to 15 and keep them for 10 to 15 years despite their really horrible economic condition? So it just doesn't make sense. Also forced castration. So there's no actual basis for this forced castration misconception. And also Section 363A of the IPC criminalizes any minors kidnapping and begging, and castration is also an offense under the IPC. So we talked about certain prejudices that is associated with the Hijra community, and a lot of times they are considered to be abnormal, talked about as freaks. And also when you have to use an abuse for effeminate men, you use the term Hijra and other really horrible terms such as I would not use them. And also the second particular prejudice is that they extort money through indecent behavior. They particularly sing ballads, obscene songs or something else, and they take money from you. However, what is most prominent is that Section 294 criminalizes songs and ballads and obscenity in the public place. Next thing that Rajesh Talwar talks about is sex and gender. He talks about sex in the term that are there only two sexes? So what Oakley talks about is that there is no biological divide at birth or at conception. Maybe I should correct that. So when conception happens, when the basic biological fertilization happens, there is no sex at all. So that is the basis for Oakley saying that there is no biological divide. And Anne Foster Sterling, another scholar, she talks about five sexes actually, not just two. And these other three sexes, apart from the most commonly known, are different variations of intersex and hermaphrodites. Then, are there two genders? So Simone de Beauvoir, the lady whose photo is on the left, she said this very common phrase, one is not born, but rather becomes a woman. Through socialization and other, through people treating you as women, you become a woman. So gender is a social construct. We perform our duties as a lady. We perform our femininity. The next thing I want to talk about is Moni and two twins. So what happened in this case was, there were, shouldn't have said two twins, a set of twins maybe. So what happened in this case was, a set of twins, both of them had ambiguous sexual organs. And what happened was, they at an early age, they decided that one will be a man, one will perform as a boy, and one will get a surgery to become a girl. And both of them were born with ambiguous sexual organs, but through this surgical intervention, they got a sex reassignment surgeries, and then both of them started performing differently. By performing differently, I mean that one little girl, by the time she was five, she liked playing with dolls, wearing frilly frocks, etc. And the other started playing sports, the one who was assigned boy. Also, Catherine O'Donovan talks about that there's rigidity in this bisection, that you have to be either a man or a woman, at least sexually. So in the end, I would like to talk about the comparative study that Rajesh Talwar talks about. So with transsexuals of the West, there is a possibility of sophisticated sex reassignment surgeries. In a lot of countries, sex reassignment is not just legal, it is the costs of the surgery are borne by the state. I think UK, if I'm not wrong. And also, this term transsexuals includes both male and female transsexuals. However, it is very restrictive. So Kessler and McKenna talk about how this term is very restrictive and is either black or white. You have to pick one gender. You have to either be a male transsexual or a female transsexual. And what about people who don't feel either? Who don't want to be a man, who don't want to be a woman, who want to have a non-binary way of life? So, and in the Hijras of South Asia, he talks about how it's, we talked about before this, key 90% of Hijras are castrated men. And also they have ambiguous names. Some will have names of a man, but all of them as a rule identify as a woman. Historically, during Mughal India and even in China, they were much accepted and even titled or landed. And you might have seen the movie Jodha Akbar, where also you might have seen Game of Thrones, where Varys is a very prominent character. However, outsiders are accommodated also in this community. Homosexuals, bisexual, sexuals are also accommodated in this community. However, some Hijras see it as an attack on their turf, and which is why castration became a norm. And although it is not necessary, but one commonality through both of these communities, apart from the general East-West, is that both of them feel a dissatisfaction from their existing sexual identity and sexual organs. These are additional readings if anyone wants a ContraPoints coming out video, or I feel like a lot of background to this I got from reading Niveda Menon and seeing like a feminist, although she is not an intersectional feminist. Thank you. I will stop sharing now.
Thank you, Rhea. That was excellent presentation on Rajesh Talwar and additional reading that you have brought in. And also any connecting your presentation to the popular things like Jodha Akbar and other characters from novels was a good thing to do. It's important to connect the readings to our real life. What I want to ask you, the rest of the class, have you understood the difference between sexual orientation and gender? These are two different aspects. And I'll give you an example from Lakshmi Narayan Tripathi. She's a Hijra activist. She was born a male, but she thought she was a female in her inside. And as she grew up in her puberty age, she was attracted to men. So she thought that she was a gay person. She was a homosexual. And as she got to know more people in the field, in the community, they told her that no, she is heterosexual. So suddenly it's very confusing that a person with male features attracted to males, how can that person be heterosexual? So then they said, because inside you think you are a woman. So you think you are a woman and you are attracted to the men, therefore you are heterosexual. So she was a trans sexual person. She wanted her transformation of the body to a woman. And when she did become a woman and she's attracted to men, she becomes a heterosexual. But in her own growth, she went through that phase where she did not make a distinction between her sexual orientation and her gender identity. So her gender identity was a she, while by body she was a he, and she was attracted to the men. So that's a major difference one has to understand, that having a sexual orientation, and it is not that all transsexual persons will be heterosexual or they will be homosexual. They might be transsexual as well as transgender. There may be a man who is who thinks that he is a female and is attracted to a female. So remember, we were talking about the shades of transsexuality. There's not one color. There are very many shades of sexuality and gender identities. And therefore, having the seven color flag, rainbow flag, is reflecting that complexity of their existence. So I'll share with you my slides on some of the terms we need to get familiar with. And also, I think important point which Ria made was that when we think of hijras, we think that they are all castrated at least, or they do not have clear organs. Even though 90% of the hijras were castrated men, but not hijras are castrated. So it is not that all hijras, for them to become hijra, they must get a castration done. This is called nirvana. So all men who want to adopt the identity of a hijra do not get castration done. So it's all, these are all information which is available in research. People have worked with them. Our exposure to hijras is these people coming on marriages and coming on childbirth and being at the red lights. And we do not know anything more than that. They have their own language. So what will be the difference between a castrated man, a trans man who has got undergone operations? So hijra is a community which has got its own identity by its actions, by its customs, by its... So they've got a very strict rules. So I did read Lakshmi's autobiography, Me Lakshmi, Me Hijra. And that's where she talks about all these inside stories about the Hijras community. And she makes this point that Nirvana is not that every Hijra goes through. Some of them go through, some of them don't. And certainly the Hijra community is very careful before somebody takes this very extreme step of getting themselves castrated, because that's a non-reversible process and it's a very painful process. So certainly Hijra community, the other point that it's been always feared that they will kidnap a child, which does not happen. And it is much more a fear rather than a reality that castrated, intersex children are taken away by the Hijra community. It is much more that we oust those children from ourselves, we don't really accept them, and therefore they find family and affiliation with the community which accepts them with open arms. So with that, let's look at some other terms we want to understand for clarity purposes.
Ma'am, I want to ask one question, ma'am.
Yes, please.
Ma'am, India mein hijras ko ma'am voting rights diya hua hai citizenship ke liye before 2013. Because LGBT ka jo judgment aaya tha, wo 2013 mein aaya tha. जिसके अंदर सुप्रीम कोर्ट हैज ग्रांटेड दैट कि ओके दिस कम्युनिटी शुड बी रिकॉग्नाइज्ड आल्सो
हिजरास वर हैविंग देयर राइट्स बाय क्लासिफाइंग देमसेल्व्स एज मेन देयर वाज नो सेपरेट कैटेगरी कॉल्ड हिजरा
सो दे हैव टू स्पेसिफाई ओनली मेंस नॉट फीमेल
दे कुड मतलब बट दे चोज हाउ दे वांट टू आइडेंटिफाई देमसेल्व्स दे हैड टू फॉल इन द बाइनरी फॉर देम टू एंजॉय एनीथिंग So I do remember that there had been hijras who have been elected to offices, and even though they're known as hijras, they will because this all this question has been that if they commit an offense, which prison will they go? Will they go to men's prison or will they go to women's prison? And that's a major issue, that which toilets will they use? All these questions have been there. So most of the time, whichever identity they take, so it was not questioned, I believe, that they were not to undergo, because in the Transgender Act now they've said that for you to claim an identity, you must go through the sex change operation, and that should be proved before the authority, before they can do that. That's what they're objecting to, that till NALSA judgment did not ask them to go through the operations for them to choose an identity. So it's a very ambiguous area left to the individuals, and many a times we have instances where the person classifies themselves as female, but they are not accepted as female. And also the other point, which was Rawlings and all other, was that, you know, the lesbian women, for example, when I was saying yesterday that LGBT, all the four have got different issues. So in case of lesbian women, it is kind of, they are not accepted by even the women themselves as part of themselves. And certainly they are not accepted by the other people because they do not have the same, the heterosexual sexuality. So they have their struggles are different than the homosexuals. Within homosexuals, they are the men and they have their own status. They're only dealing with the sexuality aspect. But lesbian women are dealing with two statuses simultaneously, of being same sexual preferences as well as being women. And their struggles are different than the struggle of what we call as the women's struggles. So whether the lesbian woman is a woman is something which, you know, sometimes some people are questioning. But the fact that we realize that sexuality and our personal identity are two different things. I don't know, the sexuality is only part of the personality, it's not the total personality. So that's what we need to understand.
Ma'am?
Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
While we are talking about transsexual and transgender, so transsexuals are basically person who belongs to one particular sex and they feel that they belong to different sex, and we are constantly using the term that feel like women, feel like men.
Yeah.
So I fail to understand, what does it mean feel like a woman and men, and if we are actually stereotyping what this is, what it feels like to be a man or a woman, aren't we stereotyping the same thing, that a woman is supposed to act in a certain way? A
sex, you were not there in one of our earlier classes when we did address this question. But last semester, this was the question our students also asked, and we were all at loss to find out what is this feeling of being the other in a different body. So we had a student in the faculty who was open about her orientation. So she came to our class, and we all asked her the same question, that, you know, you are a man by biology and you think you are a woman. So what is this feeling? You know, how do you define? Because in the case of, you know, the other people, we said, okay, how do you determine? And that was the first question I actually asked in this session to ourselves, that if we think we are a woman and we are a man, what are the features about us being man or a woman? And we are all at a loss because we are brought up like girls, we were brought up by like boys, and we have never thought about that question. So this person, Ray is her name, she is now in final year. So she was having this huge problem that she wanted to dress up like a woman, she felt like a woman, but she was a man and she had not talked about this in her own family. She wanted to dress up like women. So she comes to the faculty, you know, she used to come to the faculty with her saris and jewelry and everything. And now she wants to change her clothes in the toilet. Neither men would permit her in the toilet, nor the girls would permit her in the toilet. And that was the starting point. So we did ask her this question, that how do you know, what is it that makes you think that you are a woman? She says, not to think of yourself that you are at sea and you want to anchor somewhere. So when I think of humanity as the anchor, it is the females in that humanity with whom I anchor. I do not anchor, I do not think I'm like them. So that was her answer to this question of how do you feel? That, no, why do you think, no, what does it make you feel? Says, no, who are the other set of people I relate to? So that was her answer. And to us, you know, that kind of made more sense, because once you're trying to identify that, no, what you feel like a woman, we were completely at a loss, that it is your, is it your biology, it is your sociology, what is it that makes you? But she said, no, this is my kind of relationship with the other, that I relate to women as the ones that I belong to rather than to the men. So, okay, I think I'll recap what we have been talking about so far. We started with the question of whether human beings are same and different. Anyone, any quick answer?
Can you please repeat the question?
Can you see the slide? Are the slides visible to you?
No, ma'am.
No, madam.
No?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
He says stop sharing. So let me see. Let me start again.
Meanwhile, I request you, ma'am, to please clarify the distinction between hijra and kinnar, please.
We do not know, because that's a term which nobody has clearly explained. Sex and gender. You can see the slide now.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Same, ma'am. Same.
The same?
Yes, ma'am.
Anybody who has a different opinion?
Different but equal.
Different.
Yeah, they are same. Some respect are different and some other respect. So there's no one answer. They are same because they're all human beings. They all have tears. They all have sentiments. They all have, they're different in bodies. They're different in their expectation, you know, the role expectations of the parties. Isn't this? So certainly there, and certainly the third point is that merely because they're different does not mean that they are unequal. And that's the point of the study that we are going through. So the two terms we have been talking about, sex and gender, we started with this understanding that sex is biologically determined. And then in this category, we have the question about the hormones. When the testosterone level in the female body is much higher, then we have a problem of determining whether this person's sex is to be determined by the body or by the hormones. So we have DNA determination of sex, then intersex persons, transgender. So all, how do you classify these persons to determine whether that's, so therefore, even the sex category technically is very difficult to divide the human population into only two binaries of male and female. Then we said gender is sociologically constructed and it is the behavior. And this is what Maura Gatens has challenged, saying that even sex is gendered. So this is all what we have been talking about so far. All this we have already discussed. I just wanted to sum up that this is all what we have discussed already. So now we will talk about sexual identities. So we can talk about three categories: homosexual, heterosexual, and bisexual. So this is only at the thinking level that we're talking about the sexual identities. They might be actually doing it, they may not be sexually active in any of these forms. Homosexual is a person who fantasizes, eroticizes, and have sexual intercourse with members of her or his same sex. So this is only, imagine it is a fantasy also. It's not that the person may be actually having sex, but it is only that what this person in their mind is attracted to. Heterosexuals are persons, similar scenario, with members of her or his opposite sex. And this opposite is again now, opposite was only two categories, but if there are more, then we are again left with those. So therefore, that case, I'm forgetting the name, Arun Kumar, where this person has married a trans woman person. So that's not really opposite in the same sense. Understood, but it is certainly not your same sex is what opposite stands here for. So bisexual is a person who fantasizes, eroticizes, and have sexual intercourse with members of both. The varied range of bisexuality exists. This newspaper only is, I forget now which Western celebrity, she's talking about, she is a bisexual person and she says that, no, I like dating women more than I do the men. So which means that she has been dating both categories of persons. But gender identity is different from sexual identity. Sexual identity was about sexual attraction. Gender identity is how we present ourselves to the society. So man usually refers to the masculine male. So masculinity is referring to aggression, body build, dominant, all these are the categories which come in the category of masculine. And women are the feminine, the hourglass figure, beautification, and all these things which we think is feminine. So those women who are onto that category are traditionally, that's how they are brought up. And others are the trans persons and gender fluid. When we say trans person and gender fluid, sometimes you, and somebody was saying in our class also, that sometimes you feel one way, in a different manner. So it's not that you have a fixed personality on all the days. And certainly the others will be a whole range of persons when we look at that. One need to note that gender is a social construct which might not necessarily go along with an individual's biological sex. A member of male sex can sometimes have attributes assigned to members of female sex by her or his contemporary society. and could be perceived as and can identify with feminine gender and vice versa. So she was talking about effeminate men, and there are tomboy girls. So these are the also possibilities of a variation of the gender roles. The tomboy girls are all climbing trees and jumping up and down and mixing with boys. So these are the categories. We refer to a girl as a tomboy. And the boys are referred to as sissies. Certainly, they're not complimentary terms. And that's going to change as we go along in our understanding and acceptance. So social, cultural, and political identities based on sexuality. So this is now moving on from sexuality to social, cultural, and political. When you look at these three terms, gay, lesbian, and queers, so gay and lesbians are corresponding to what we call as homosexual, and homosexual is the mental category, but this is a political identity where the people who are actively, they are out and they are working towards the rights of homosexuals, then men will be referred to as gays and girls will be referred to as lesbians. Queer is another category which is comparatively later. And these are set of people who do not want to be again put into a box. Sometimes they want to assert that identity. So there might be a homosexual person who is not out there. He is not showing any other visual clue to say that this person is homosexual or lesbian. But then there would be others who would want to dress up differently to assert their personality. So some of them, initially, they wanted to be called themselves as queer, that we are, it's queer is not a term of shame, but it is an assertion of power over their individuality and assertion of personality over that. So we'll try to understand each one of these terms. So when you look at gay, this is a homosexual, mostly males, who identify with the conscious efforts of building a community, assert and establish the rights to be different, organize advocacy events like Pride March, etc., to create awareness and positive visibility, struggle to reclaim terms and behaviors looked down upon. So this is the activist among the homosexual males who will be referred to as gay. We use the term gay and homosexual interchangeably, but in the community, they make a difference between the two because the gay person is actively out there, but homosexual may be in the cupboard as well. They might be not even practicing homosexuality, but in their mind, and we do know that a lot of homosexuals get married to a heterosexual couple and then they're having issues with the partner because they cannot deal with the demands of a heterosexual union. Similarly, when you look at the very term gay, talks about this reclaiming and advocacy. Please note, all homosexuals are not gays, and trans persons do not identify themselves at all as gays. So this is the point I was making, that Lakshmi Narayan Tripathi, for example, she is not gay. She's a trans person. She got herself operated and became a woman, but and attracted to the men, and therefore she is not gay, even though she is an activist. So therefore, there are variations and angles to this conversation. Now look at lesbian. In broad sense, they are the counterpart of the gay males and men. But there are subtle differences. Within patriarchy, biological females have their own struggles being women. We just mentioned, and historically, female sexuality is in general, is neglected and invisibilized. As a result, lesbians have to struggle harder than gay men as women, then as homosexuals, and also as homosexual women. So there are two disabilities attached to them. Their position in women's movement and feminist politics is different, and it is harder for them to get included in the feminist debates as well. So queer, gay and lesbians were institutionalized, becoming boxed, and therefore they feel better to get identified as queer. And while some have been not finding it, there are different sets of people with different ideologies within the broad category called trans, and everybody has their own preference. You know, in a parallel, we can think of Americans. So in America, previously, earlier, there were the term Negro for the black. Then there were the black. Then there were black American. Then there were African American. There are lots of terms to refer to the same community. And now people have said, okay, how would you like yourself to be referred to? Because one has own preferences and ideology to say, this is more appropriate for me. Okay. And this is kind of behavioral term, MSM, where men are actually having sex. So MSM may be a gay, may be a homosexual, because this is only the behavioral aspect of their existence and not necessarily their political identity as self. Apart from self-identified gay, bi, and queer men for males, it also includes people practicing same-sex behavior, though clandestine pursuit, through clandestine pursuits, and maintain an otherwise straight face instead of subscribing to any aforementioned identities. Then we have MSM, transperson in hijras, an umbrella term. MTH is another one. So we have all this terminology, which is LGBT, Q, H, plus, 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 I, plus, plus, plus. So MTH is another one to refer to these three sets of persons. An umbrella term coined by a particular intervention to encompass and allow provisions of service to people with MSS, MSM, as well as trans and hijras. Before entering in the world of transgression, we need to understand that gender is a social construct and not a natural or biological fact. This is re-emphasizing. It changes from time to time, place to place, culture to culture, class to class, one religion to another. When you look at this depiction of Ram, with all the jewelry, with all the beautification, all the lipstick and all that, the color of the clothing. In fact, this is not the colors we assign to the male clothing, but we have accepted this as a category for the gods. But when a human being does that, then we find it very difficult to accept that person. We say, oh, you are dressed like a woman, but we dress our gods and goddesses, so we do not question that. So somewhere there's a disjunction between how do we perceive of our gods, how do we present them visually, and what people do in their real lives. Social, the transgender as an identity, social gender construct existing in the context of individual dictates certain gender roles and responsibilities. This is what we've been talking about all this while. And technically, transgender is any person who transgresses the contemporary gender norms. So a tomboy will be a transgender in that sense. So these are the broadest possible category in which we can use this term. I want you to look at these personalities, as we had also shown some. These are all people, celebrities, who are asserting their acceptance of the other in their dressing patterns. And in contrast, we have these pictures from our TV serials. Do you think these are transgender, transvestite persons? This is just a spoof on them. It is not giving them any respect. It is only making a caricature of the trans persons. Somewhere, whenever we have Buddhi and all these characters in our serial, they are not providing any respect to this person who is trans in their presentation. So somewhere the images in the previous slide and the images here give you a very, very different message about how to deal with these persons who are different from us. Transgender is an umbrella term, and that's how they have used in the NALSA judgment, and it may include many of these. Some of these are here. Ria has already mentioned to transvestite, which is a cross-dressing. There might not be any sexuality issues there. There may not be any gender issues there. They just like to dress up differently. We call them drag queens also. The drag queens may or may not be a transgender person or transsexual person in the technical sense of the term, but transgender being the umbrella term will include transvestites. Invisible transgender who feel like feminine, male or a woman in a wrong body, or a masculine female or a man in a wrong body, but they do not expose themselves. And most of the people who are different are not able to express themselves, and that's where a lot of this closeting happens. Koti is an identity specific to Indian subcontinent, adopted by someone who feels like a feminine male or a woman in a wrong body, and finds comfort in expressing this non-conformity in various ways. Have you understood this? In the male group, it will be there might be a union of a partnership of two men. One of them feels like a female. So without having undergone any kind of medical intervention, they still perform the role of the woman, and they are happy to be identified themselves as Koti. I was at a wedding. Rhea mentioned Robert Wentworth. I went to his wedding with another male from Malaysia. And at that point of time, I was staying with a gay couple. We've been together for the last 30 years. And visually, you could not make out anything about their personality being different from any other, what we call as ordinary looking men. They were both refined human beings, but they have been in relationship for the last 30 years. And one of them was a human rights activist. The other was an opera singer. And the fellow who was opera singer was looking after the whole family affairs, cooking, gardening, keeping the house in order and all. But he was not asserting that as a woman in the relationship. But this Koti category is also asserting their identity as a woman in the relationship, and they themselves identify themselves as Kotis. There was a question I heard.
Ma'am, while talking about transvestites who dress up, like who cross dresses, mm-hmm. So also we assign, okay, this particular dress is of a male and this particular dress is of a female.
Because we have very categorically done that. And but, I kind of, you know, look at ourselves. How many girls are wearing jeans? I think almost all. In our class, and you know, in the faculty, there would be hardly any girl who will not be wearing jeans or trousers. But how many men wear salwar kameez? Not even one. And if one does, then they are the outcast. Somewhere, dressing also is power. So girls are happy; they feel very liberated and empowered when they wear suits and they wear the male clothes. But when Baba Ramdev ran away wearing the salwar kameez, how much spoof was there? How much fun he was made of? And of course, you have to say, oh, these are my mother's clothes, so I'm fine with that. But wearing women's clothes is not seen as a sign of empowerment. But wearing something which has traditionally been considered as a male clothing is seen as a sign of empowerment. So there is a lot of behavioral, lot of visual clues to determine who to respect, how much to respect, you know, what kind of status that person is to be given. So it's not so when we are talking about the transvestite, it may be either way: the men wanting to dress as women or women wanting to dress as men, but they're desire is only limited to clothing. And certainly, you know, at some point of time, when you look at Scottish old timers, they still wear, you know, they used to wear skirts. That is gone now out of fashion. So skirts is now seen categorically, especially the skirts with the small waist and a lot of flare on the bottom. It's typically women. No?
Heels were worn by men in the earlier times, which is now considered as a feminine cloth probably.
Yeah, but today when you talk about heels, you know, we do know that women continue to wear heels despite so many disabilities caused, physical disability caused by the heels. And in some firms, it's essential for women employees to wear heels, even though this causes a lot of deformity in their feet, apart from the discomfort and pain they suffer. So somewhere, when you look at the women clothing, this is very disabling. It does not give them free movement. running around, etc. It's very hard for women to be living in those clothes. And to look at the male's clothes, they are free. They can climb trees. They can do whatever they want to. Now look at this. Another thing I was remembering, bicycles. So there were ladies' bicycles and there are the male bicycles. Why do we have to have separate bicycles for women? She said, okay, you know, because they can't get their feet up like that, the men do. Okay, then if the female designed bicycle, can that not be used by men? So there's a very, you know, there's very unexplained categorizations of things we use for different sets of people. In America, there was the latest thing that pink, what do you call them? Shave karne ko kya hota hai? The boys
razor,
use that
razor.
So razor blades for men, blue for girls, pink. I mean, there's marketing strategy. So there's a lot of marketing happens around gender roles, etc.
There are razors available, razors only for girls and razors only for boys. So I don't understand. They are both hairs. They need to shave. I don't know what is the difference between.
No, that's what I'm saying. That even young children start saying, "Nahi, nahi, pink nahi pehnunga, ladkiyan pehnti hain." So we bring up these gender identities in our from the very point. No, about chote bache kapde to jhabla jab tak pehen rahe hain bache tab tak, no, it can be either. But the moment it comes to frocks, frock cannot be turned on or bought for the boys. So girls can be given knickers, but boys can't be given frocks. So very categorically in the dressing, we create an identity. But what we were saying, transvestite are categorically following that category, so which is seen as male clothing and as a female clothing. Okay, coming to intersex persons, these are individuals with different degrees of variations. So the chromosome, gonad, genitals, and do not allow her or him to be distinctly identified as a male or a female. Then we have females, individuals out of choice surgically remove or retain or add certain physical attributes that make them appear as someone belonging to both the sexes. We have another hijra we have been already talking about, but remember there's a major difference in hijras irrespective of their bodies because they have a whole culture to themselves, which is not true for all other groups because those are all other groups are individuals in their own right. But hijras create a whole community with their separate language, traditions. They are taught to how to, you know, the special clapping they have. So all these mannerism is taught to them when they become part of that community. Transsexual is the person who is so unhappy with their biological body that they actually undergo surgical intervention to complete change or partial change in their bodies. Transgender is just an ideological category again. It is not necessarily a biological category. So the person is not happy with the gender which has been assigned as per his or her body. So they are, instead of identify with any of the two assigned gender identity, the person beyond the binary, both male to female and female to male transgenders are there. And they're gender fluid person, sometimes one personality is higher than the other. Gender queer is a catch-all category for gendered identities beyond the binary of man and woman or masculine and feminine. Then we have this other, you know, counterpart of the Kothi's pantheogiriya, which is not a self-identity, but the other person in the relationship refers to you as the man in the union. So when the Kothi considers someone masculine enough, the Kothi calls that man as her panthi or giriya. Then we have performance-based identities. What are their positions in the sexual interactions? One is top or active, bottom or passive, and then versatile. They can perform either functions. So all these are the performance-based identities. Bottoms are not really passive always, and there are no necessarily feminine, while all feminine person are not necessarily bottoms. So this is conclusion of this whole conversation, that gender identities, social identities, and sexual identities do not always go hand in hand. You may have a gender identity different than your sexual identity. Social cultural identity may be different than what your actual activity has been. Trans persons often consider it to be insulting to be equated with homosexual, and all homosexual persons don't have gender non-conformities. It is similar manner, all homosexuals are not gay identified. Is that clear? Because we did say, keep thinking of Lakshmi Narayan Tripathi, her sexual identity was different than her gender identity. Identity can be overlapping, identities can be evolving. Because of social oppression, all these identities become very strong and important. They are not the sole feature of individual's persona. I'll give you an example. When I first got exposed to these others, quote unquote, I was in US and was teaching a course there with another colleague. And I had a student who brought a son with him to the class, young boy. And he said, this is our son adopted by my partner. So he was a practicing homosexual who have adopted a son. So my first impression was that they don't like women. And I was a little intrigued that if they, and also they don't like families was my bias towards them. So I thought to myself that, no, they don't want family. Why have they adopted a son? And also the fact that they've adopted a son means so that, no, they don't want to even adopt a daughter. So these are all my initial thoughts. Then I talked to my friend who teaches in Australia, and she's known as the South Asian feminist out there. So she brought me to this notice that, no, these are our presumptions, that if somebody is not heterosexual, we believe they don't like families. They like families. Heterosexuality is only one part of their existence. Sexuality is only a part of our personality. That's not the all. So they are happy to be fathers. They're happy to be brothers. They're happy to be sons and daughters and whatever their personalities are. It is only their sexual orientation which is different. But for me, I was conflating the two in the beginning. And today, certainly, I'm much more exposed and much more aware of. So somewhere when you say this important point that sexual identity and gender identity is only one part of their identity. That is not the sum total of them. They continue to be. And in that sense, that film, Philadelphia, is really good. It's about a homosexual lawyer who gets thrown from his office because of this category, and he files a suit and all this. And that's the film which shows his family ties so very actively that you start thinking that, yeah, there is a lot more to a person than just their personality. This we have already done, personality traits. So, stop sharing. Let's come back to here. So now, do you have any clarifications, any observations to make?
Madam, as I would like to make observation rather query. As we discussed that women is a social construct. Am I right?
In the sense of what you're saying, if I'm making a distinction between female and woman, then yes, woman is a social construct.
Social construct. So can you tell us that how that identification evolved from developed countries and in developing countries? So the things are much complex in developing countries, and sensing and being aware in the developed countries, as you talked about Philadelphia example and all, somewhere the people are making the male position dominating over women, whether we talk about the developed country or developing country. Hope you're getting my point.
Yeah, so no, in fact, that's what I also thought at some point of time, that in West, women have got a lot more equality. But my couple of years there in different contexts, in the UK, I was there for a year, in Russia, I was there a year, and about 4 months I was in US. And that longish stay does tell us that actually, substantively, it's not different. In UK, when I was there, the police departments were doing training on gender and equality, you know, gender segregation. And they mentioned that in UK, these educated Western women took 27 times of beating and domestic abuse before they approached the police. 27 times. On an average, national average was 27 times. So it is not that because they have become equal, they are not facing domestic violence. In the US, I found that they have to do this complete relocation of a person, a new identity to be given. The men were so abusive, and the abuse was in domestic relationships, not only in the marriages, but also in living relationships. And it was to the extent that even though the relationship has ended, she might have taken a divorce, she might have got out of the living relationship, but the man pursues them in order to, you know, to the extent of killing. So they had to be relocated with a new identity so that this man cannot trace them. We had a refuge for women, and that was very new to me, that 20 years that refuge was working for women, to shelter women. And the address of that was not known publicly. The local taxi drivers knew that place. And if a battered woman came into that, whatever the system was, but just to ensure that the abusive husband or the ex-boyfriend does not come tracking that woman to that house. So for me, the violence was so prevalent in the developed countries, and developed countries also, you know, that's why there were the substantive category. All my colleagues, we still had this primary responsibility of ensuring that when their children come, when their caretaker, the nanny leaves at 5 o'clock, they have to be at home. They cannot leave the child alone. So the responsibility is primarily on the woman. Domestic responsibility in the West is also very much there. So when you get machines, etc., certainly the work of the woman in the with all the gadgets is comparatively less than the Indian housewife will be. But she still is responsible to ensure that the food is there on the table. So even if it is the tinned food which has to be brought on the table, it still is the woman. So on the face of it, there would seem my initial impression about Russia were that women, because they were very visible compared to the Indian scenario. At night, you will find very few women on the roads. In Russia, that was not an issue. But when it came to the family setup, the woman's primary responsibility still remains. So it is, you know, that visually they will seem like a lot more independent, but substantively not much has changed. They are still struggling. And, you know, in India, we got lots of things on platter. We never had to fight for right to vote. But imagine the West. They had to fight even for the right to vote. So certainly and more awareness also means more frictions, and certainly the individualistic approach of their lifestyle makes it even harder when it's a difficult scenario that you are in. It's not that it's easier in India, because the family setup is so strongly built on the marriage that women are kept being sent back to the same abusive home even when she complains. The parents are no less contributory to the domestic violence continuing, because no support is provided to this girl who wants to leave that abusive home. So psychologically, she is not ready. Financially, she is lesser. And then this whole creation of motherhood, that she must look after the children. She feels guilty if she leaves her children behind in an abusive relationship. So then she is, as it is, she does not know from where her food is going to come. And to then decide to take her children along with her is equally difficult as it is difficult to leave them behind. So there are lots of, you know, this whole West and South division is more at a superficial level. Substantively, women across the world are not equal. They're not paid equally. Despite whatever, you know, we would say in India now, women are abusive, they are ministers, they are there at all positions. But these are minuscule numbers. The culture still remains the same. I remember Nuri's statement. Nuri, who was the, I think, Pepsi chief. So she says, the day I was made the CEO, I came home happy to announce that I have got this position. And her mother asked her that, you know, why have you come so late, and just go and get the milk. So she asked that, isn't my husband at home? He says, yeah, वो ऑफिस से आके आराम कर रहा है. But I also came back from office, CEO of Pepsi, and she narrated this incident that the moment I enter my home, I am the housewife. My responsibility to get the milk still remains even I'm the CEO. And that's what the status of women is all about. That on the outside world, they can keep wanting to be equal and not only wanting to be, they are being treated at many times as equal. But the moment they return to the family fold, they are first the woman in the house. The responsibilities are not different.
Ma'am, I would like to ask one question, ma'am.
Yes,
ma'am. Mentioned with respect to the payment, there is a gender discrimination between men and female. But my point is that, ma'am, in government sector, it is static. Whether you are man or female, you are holding a position, you will get the payment irrespective of that. It is only in the private sector where you can say that ki there is some discrimination between the payment. Mm-hmm. But the point is that civil is a kind of, in civil society, getting a job is a kind of struggle itself. Mm-hmm. Job hi kam hai, ma'am, wahan pe.
There are a couple of things here to think about. No, we got this recent judgment of the Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court said that the deceased woman's worth in terms of compensation will be the same as her husband. So if the husband is the CEO, he's getting 15 lakh salary, so her death compensation will also be 15 lakh. So if the husband is getting 5,000, she will get 5,000. So her worth is determined by what the husband is worth, even though the nature of work between the two is very different. Woman of the CEO does the same work which the woman of the laborer does. So their work is same, but their compensation will be different depending on what their husbands were doing. And that's something you will have to see when you see doctors and nurses, for example. You cannot say that they are having different pay because they're doing different work. But whether the work of the doctor is as important or more important than the work of the nurse in the hospital, or whether both of them are equally important, or whether the difference in their contribution to the patient's recovery is so much different as the parity in pay. So when you say government servant, so government is paying one kind of salary, and I kind of came across it with the judges in the Judicial Academy. The junior most judge, the first level judge, was getting the salary scale at the same level which I was getting as a professor, which is the highest category in my cadre.
Exactly, ma'am. That's what I'm saying.
No. So the question I'm asking is that most of the judges were men. Most of the teachers are women. So whether that is also a constitution determining what will be the salary scale. And that's what the equality studies today are asking. In our houses, we have a maid and we have a driver. So the driver works 10 to 5 and actually does only two rounds usually. If I am an office going person, he'll take me to the office. He'll sleep there in his car, do nothing more than, you know, read novels, hear music. Then evening, he'll bring me back. He gets 18,000 rupees a month. And he takes his Saturday and Sunday off also. And I have a maid servant who might be working for me 5 hours, 7 hours, 12 hours continuously every day, 7 days a week. She's paid 5,000 rupees. Why? Whether the contribution of the maid is less than the driver's contribution. So the manner in which we determine the scale of pay is very much dependent on who are the takers of that work, who are the doers of that work. But if we start looking at what is the contribution of this person's work in my life or in the society. So Germany, they said teacher's worth is uncomparable to anybody else, because without a teacher, nobody will become an engineer, nobody will become a professor, nobody will become a doctor, lawyer, judge, you name it. All professionals are created by teachers. Therefore, teachers should be paid the highest salary. So there are different ways to determine salary scales. So the equal pay for equal work merely says that if you are the secretary, whether you are a male secretary or a female secretary, you will get the same pay. But majority of the secretaries will be girls, will be women. So the salary scale of the women will be much less compared to, so therefore determining, one is that within the same work, you have to be paid equal, and certainly even that is not followed, even if it is limited to the private companies. Mm-hmm. It is the worth of the person's contribution. So how much is this person contributing to my comfort? Certainly my merit contribution, not more than the driver does. But we, without questioning, pay the driver more. Then the other thing, no. The merit is doing unskilled work. The driver is doing skilled work. And therefore, the driver will be entitled to more. But whether for his education, should I be paying more? I should be paying for what the comfort this person is bringing in my life. But that's not how the pay scales are done. Drivers are usually men. The maids are usually women. So there is a very gendered manner in which we determine salaries. In addition to this whole thing about... So when you look at construction work, the mazdoor gets paid less than the mason. Masons is a skilled work. The mazdoor is doing physical work. Why have we given more credence to the skill work than the physical labor? He's working so much harder. All those educated people who do the mental work are paid more than people who are toiling in the sun. Why is their work less important than the professor's work who are doing a mental work? We have created values around things which are available to the powerful. Whatever they do, so the way we said that whatever men do is important, therefore, all the powerful people, whatever that they do, whatever they aspire for, has got more value in terms of money payment. So this structure is not dependent on objective criteria. How much is the, whether, so for me, the question is the same thing, that it is not so much to say that there is, both the problems exist. The laborers also, the women laborers are paid less than the male laborers are. And the logic there has been that women cannot carry as much load as men can do. For different purposes, we look at different criteria to determine. Somebody is not doing at all any physical work, but they will be paid more because they're doing mental work.
So farmers too, madam.
Huh?
Farmers too.
Yeah. So why the farmers? No, today there's a video which is going rounds on WhatsApp, which says, okay, what is the most important profession in the world? And they finally come to the conclusion to farmers, that because them, there will be no food. So certainly there are different ways to look at different categories, but the ways we have been looking at different categories is from the male's perspective, from the powerful person's perspective. And powerful persons in most societies have been men. So they determine what will be the pattern of whatever is to happen. And unless you start thinking, so certainly, this is kind of first struggle was between men and women. Now, this transgender didn't exist anywhere. They didn't exist even in the struggle for women. And when 2013 amendments were being discussed, when the Verma committee sat post Nirbhaya rape case, so they were hearing all sets of people. And I was in one of those meetings where some of the trans activists were also there. So they said the rape law should be gender neutral. Women were opposing that. Then they said, at least say this, that the victim can be any person, but the offender can be the male. Because they said, even in the trans relationships, it is the men who are raping the men. So men were raping men were raping women, they were raping children. But the perpetrator is always the man. The transsexual person or the homosexual person, they were being harassed and abused and violated by the other men. So even that the women did not agree to. They said, no, rape has got its historical context for women. It will be diluted for them. So they did not agree to that. But certainly, they were not heard even by the women. They are not able to relate that if women have been subjected to violence, the trans have been subjected to even much more violence and ostracism and ouster than women have been. But they're not able to connect to their misery. So within the disadvantaged groups also, we have this fight for our domain, that I fight for myself, I will not look at the domain of the other. For me, my interest in the trans studies arose because I wanted to know what are the struggles they are going through, whether they are following the same path as women's movements have taken or they are following a different path. So we do realize that all the ousted people, now the same story is happening about Dalits. In the Dalits also, women, Dalit women are nowhere in their conversations. And there are stories written by the Dalit women about their experience. And when they're in the movement, they're again given the task of looking after the men in the movement, cook them, take care of them. So somewhere, the categories within categories, the article which I mentioned to you, Sumit Bose's article, which is in your reading list, you know, it is included in that list I put on the Dropbox. So I'm talking about this, the intersectionality. So somewhere the struggles of all the persons who we think are different are similar, but they cannot, even those people who have suffered cannot relate to the misery of the co-sufferer, because this person belongs to another group and they don't know your problem is different than mine. But I think all the people who are suffering should have to join together. And I certainly think that this course gives us that tool to understand suffering for any group. We have taken women and gender, the trans as the group we are talking about. But you can apply this analysis from the perspective of any of the deprived groups. See the world from their experiences, from their perspective, and you will find that the law is meant actually for the powerful, whatever the power group may be in the context. You go to a police station, filing a complaint by an educated person is much easier than by a laborer. So there's a power of education. So there's a power in everything that we, you know, the manner in which we operate our society is all hierarchical. Hierarchy determined by different factors in our lives.
Correct, ma'am. Ma'am, one more question, ma'am. Ma'am, जैसे कि इंडिया को मैम एक्चुअली जो रूल्स रेगुलेशंस हैं और इवन द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन हैज बीन गिवन बाय द ब्रिटिशर्स बिकॉज कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन इटसेल्फ ड्राइव फ्रॉम 1935 एक्ट ऑफ पार्लियामेंट ब्रिटिशर्स राइट मैम तो मैम एक्चुअली बट ये ब्रिटिशर्स ने ही ट्रांसजेंडर को 1897 में ही रिकॉग्निशन दे दी थी अपने कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन में ब्रिटेन में एंड उसी के बेसिस पे इंडिया में सुप्रीम कोर्ट में ट्रांसजेंडर के लिए मतलब राइट्स मांगे जा रहे थे कि इट शुड बी रिकॉग्नाइज इन इंडियन कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन कि दिस टाइप ऑफ पीपल आर अवेलेबल इन इंडिया एंड दे शुड बी रिकॉग्नाइज एज इंडिया इज ऑल्सो रिकॉग्नाइजिंग द ब्रिटिश रूल्स रेगुलेशंस एंड लॉ समवेयर इन देयर जजमेंट एंड दे आर ऑल्सो रेफरिंग बट स्टिल डिस्पाइट ऑफ दीज थिंग्स इंडिया मतलब इंडिया में मतलब उस चीज को लाने के लिए बहुत टाइम लग गया 2013 में एक लैंडमार्क जजमेंट आया तो माय पॉइंट इज दैट मैम कि ये ऑलरेडी लोगों को पहले से भी पता था इंडियन जजेस को भी पहले से पता था बट फिर भी जो फ्रेमर्स ऑफ कॉन्स्टिट्यूशंस हैं दे हैव नॉट ब्रॉट एनी डिस्टिंक्शन बिटवीन दीज पीपल कि दीज पीपल आर एग्जिस्टिंग इन इंडिया इन द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन इन 1949 इटसेल्फ when they are writing that draft of constitution. So, ma'am, आपको opinion में इसमें पूछना चाहता हूँ कि ऐसा क्यों हुआ?
तो मेरी तो opinion बहुत simple सी है कि constitution तो हमने Indians ने ही frame किया है और सिर्फ England पे नहीं किया है बहुत सारे देशों के constitution हमने देखे थे और मुझे नहीं पता कि 1800 में England में homosexuality recognized थी because उनके तो Wolfenden committee report है बहुत बाद की जिसमें बहुत discussion हुआ है और So it's much later. But in any case, whatever, even the legislation that we have adultery, when was it closed in other countries? We have abolished the Supreme Court of adultery. So there are many things that the Britishers have given their time. And naturally, they were double standard that what is in their country and what is in the slave country, what law will happen. So we cannot say, because they have done differently in their country, so we have done differently. Their understanding was, when we were We were looking at the Whipping Act. तो उस वक्त में पहले बात हुई कि reformatory schools आएंगे, reformatory schools बनाए जाएंगे बच्चों के लिए. तो उसमें object किया उन्होंने Britishers ने ये कहते हुए कि that Indians are very conniving and very clever. They will fake offences by their children in order to get free education and residence. लिखत में opinion है ये. So therefore, उनके लिए whipping लगा दो, reformatory schools मत लगाओ. So certainly, you know, there were different standards, but it was also to the credit of Britishers that in England, when they found that in England at that point of time, 7 out of 1 prisoners were dying even though they were sent to only prison, they were not given death penalty. The conditions in prisons were so bad that one in seven was dying. Prison reform started, and they started doing it right from here also. 1864 is the first prison reform report in India. So it's not that everything the Britishers did was wrong. Something they did bring right, but we have not moved after the Britishers left from the legacy they left behind. So they moved on, they brought changes in their own laws, and they are moving much farther. We are still stuck. We are still stuck because Britishers said so. And if you look at Nas judgment, actually, you will find that Nas judgment does mention that the Victorian, this whole Victorian morality in our Indian Penal Code is there then, but they have moved from that Victorian morality, and it is the whole question of homosexuality, the issue of homosexuality is of the Christian origin. In our temples and all, we have found homosexual depictions, and therefore Indian culture did not have a problem with that. So it is a British morality that we brought in, and today we say this is Indian morality. So somewhere we are getting confused between what were the Britishers who brought, what was the things which they brought, which we have accepted as Indian, and which are the Indian things that we lost because of the British. So there's a very complicated category out there. And so certainly, you know, kind of looking at history just as to what happened. But the question is more important as to where we go from now. Where are we moving? Which direction? Nepal recognized homosexuality, and I think now they recognize marriage also. Nepal has been a Hindu country for a long time. It's only now recently become a democratic country. So even they found that it was acceptable, but we are still stuck in whatever we consider as Indian morality, while it is actually the Christian era morality with which we are stuck.
Yes, ma'am, got it.
ये मैडम एक चीज में मैं और ऐड करना चाहूंगा ये मैडम जो आपने ये दिया है ना सबवर्सिव साइड का रत्ना कपूर में उसको बहुत अच्छे से इलेबोरेट किया है इन चीजों को जब ब्रिटिशर्स कुछ चीज लाना चाहते थे तो राजा राम मोहन रॉय या दूसरे सोशल रिफॉर्मर्स जो थे दे वर नॉट एक्सेप्टिंग दैट ऑल लीगल कंटेंट फ्रॉम ब्रिटिश ओरिजिन बिकॉज एक उनको डर था कि कहीं एक कुछ अपोजिशन ना हो जाए कि जिस तरीके से मुस्लिम जो है चीजें हमारे यहाँ इंट्रोड्यूस हो गई थी उस तरीके से ब्रिटिशर्स की सारी बातें जो है इंट्रोड्यूस हो जाएंगी तो हमारा जो कल्चर नहीं रहेगा तो एक टसल रहता था ओपिनियन में कि हमको ब्रिटिशर्स के जो भी लीगल
हमेशा ही डिवाइडेड रहती है देयर इज नेवर वन ओपिनियन ऑन एनी सब्जेक्ट हिंदुस्तान क्या है पूरे देश में पूरे वर्ल्ड का ये तो है देयर विल बी डिफरेंस ओपिनियन बिकॉज ऑफ द पर्सपेक्टिव विद व्हिच यू आर लुकिंग एट इट कोई सी भी कहानियों में बताई जो हमने जैसे मैं कहानियां बहुत रेफर करती हूँ हरिश्चंद्र की हमने कहानी को रेफर किया तो जब हमें पढ़ाई गई थी वो कहानी तो पढ़ाई गई थी उसका फोकस वॉज ऑन दी स्टेटमेंट ट्रूथ कि जो उसने कह दिया वो उसको पूरा करेगा सत्यवादी राजा हरिश्चंद्र दिस वॉज द फोकस वॉज नॉट ऑन द ओनरशिप ऑफ द वाइफ एंड द सन सो टूडे वेन वी आर लुकिंग एट द सेम स्टोरी फ्रॉम द पर्सपेक्टिव ऑफ व्हाट हैपेंड टू द वाइफ एंड द सन देन वी आर क्वेश्चनिंग whether it was within his right to sell his wife and son. That was not questioned when we were told that story. There are so many stories. We do not question that. Because that was not how, so moral of the story was ki hamesha sach bolna chahiye aur jo bol diya usko pura karna chahiye kuch bhi marzi cost ho. That was the lesson told to us when we were told that story. So certainly there is a different perspective because of which abhi farmer ki struggle chal rahi hai. Farmers ka ek perspective hai, sarkar ka dusra perspective hai. दोनों सब पर्सपेक्टिव से आप उनके नजर से देखेंगे तो वो सही होएगा सो एंड लॉयर्स में भी तो ये होता है ना दैट बोथ द साइड्स थिंक दैट दिस इज माय स्टोरी इज द करेक्ट स्टोरी माय क्लेम टू द राइट इज द राइट क्लेम सो देयर इज ऑलवेज मोर देन वन पॉसिबल एक्सप्लेनेशन बिकॉज ओनली देयर विल बी डिफरेंस ओपिनियन बट एट द सेम टाइम इन द ब्रिटिश व्हेन वी यू नो सती एबॉलिशन इसका चाइल्ड इन्फेंटिसाइड लेजिस्लेशन केम इन 1834 और उसमें उन्होंने जो लेजिस्लेशन उस टाइम बनाए थे हमने आज तक नहीं बनाए उस तरह के दे सेड इफ इन अ विलेज जनरली स्पीकिंग इट इज फाउंड दैट मोर बॉयज आर बीइंग आर सर्वाइविंग देन द गर्ल्स देन द होल कम्युनिटी विल हैव टू पे अ फाइन बिकॉज देयर इज हिडन चाइल्ड इन्फेंटिसाइड कैन यू बिलीव दैट बस सीधी सी बात है कि बिना कम्युनिटी के इंटरेक्शन के की प्रोटेक्शन से चाइल्ड इन्फेंटिसाइड नहीं हो सकता था उस जमाने में. They permitted entry of the policeman in such scenario. They were suspecting that a girl has been born, he'll be killed. They could enter without, despite all parda and all categories. But for them, the human life of the girls at that point of time, 1834, it was important. And I think it's a good legislation that they created. We are still struggling with the same issue even today, 2021. This has taken, changed the form from child infanticide, it has now become to feticide. From female infanticide, this has now become to female feticide. We have not moved, despite laws, despite stringent laws, despite whatever, because somewhere we are not re-examining our understanding of who are human beings. When you look at census categories, initially you ask them, ki aapke kitne bachche hain, they'll tell you kitne sons hain. Then they started asking detail, ki acha aapke kitne ladkiyan hain, kitne ladke hain. That's how girls started getting counted. Then it was found that girls and boys may be disabled बच्चों को गिनाई नहीं रहे हैं. फिर specific question include हुआ उसमें कि बताइए कि किसी बच्चे को disability तो नहीं है. So we are focusing that our understanding of who is a human being. The trans की तो यही struggle है ना, that all our laws are saying girls and boys will inherit property, sons and daughters. तो जो trans बच्चा पैदा हुआ उसके तो हमारे पास category नहीं है. तभी राइट टू मैरिज की इशू उठ रहा है कि अब हम तो मैन एंड वुमेन की शादी कराते हैं. इवन दो सेक्स एंड प्रोक्रिएशन आर नॉट एसेंशियल इंग्रेडिएंट्स ऑफ मैरिज इन द इंडियन इन द हिंदू मैरिज एक्ट. इवन इन द इम्पोर्टेंसी केस दिस इज ओनली अवॉइडेबल मैरिज. इफ द पार्टनर्स वॉन्ट टू कंटिन्यू दे कैन कंटिन्यू. सो दे कैन कंटिन्यू विदाउट सेक्स विदाउट चिल्ड्रन एज लॉन्ग एज दे आर हेट्रोसेक्सुअल. हेट्रोसेक्सुअल ऑल्सो हैविंग नो सेक्स. Even that marriage is valid if they biologically they are two different and they belong to two. So somewhere our understanding of the exclusion is so inbuilt in our system. So anything which is different from these two categories, even marriages without consent are valid marriage. They're only voidable. Gun laga karke bhi aapne phere kara diye to shaadi ho gayi. This is all what our laws is saying, huh? So somewhere the technicalities of laws are not necessarily the real experiences of people. And the experiences of people is not people, actually it is the men. That's what we are questioning constantly, that our standard of standard human being is the male human being in our society. And it is their perspective, their experiences, their reactions which determine what will the norm, be. We will, you know, our initial four topics are more conceptual in nature. Then we will see the application of all these in our laws. You've seen some of them, no? This question may not have been raised in your family law class. But remember your family law classes. And we do know that presently, they, you know, Hindu Marriage Act, Special Marriage Act, Foreign Marriage Act, all the three are under challenge. Because the same-sex persons want to get themselves registered or married under those laws.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, yes. We need to do the cross-sectional studies also. Then only we'll come to know where they are hitting. And legal approach is very meager in our country. This is the reason why we are not able to understand the complexity and the contradictions of legal opinions and legal
when you're saying that the Constituent Assembly did not talk about hijra, means look at the interpretation. We do not know whether the Constituent Assembly wanted women to be discriminated. Because when you look at 15(3), categorically they were wanting to make them equal by the special laws. But by one interpretation by Gajendra Gadkar, the whole family law has been excluded from her fundamental rights. Saying the phrase personal laws exist in entry 5 in concurrent list, but does not form part of Article 13. So we do not know it was the framers, it was the judges later on, which excluded women from equality. So if women itself, which were recognized, hijras are nowhere mentioned, understandable. But women who are recognized as a special group in constitution, they have also been excluded from equality. So we do not know what the framers were wanting, or what they were thinking about. But we do know that the interpretations have not been promoting equality and inclusiveness.
Ma'am?
Yeah.
Recently, like a few days back, NCC made a reply to the plea that transgender should be allowed in NCC, National Cadet Corps.
Mm-hmm.
And they said that it is going to, between trans women and women, it is going to, give privilege to the trans women. And when it compares to trans men and men, it will give privilege to men. Mm-hmm. And they said that only transsexual would be allowed because the plea given that the girl who gave the plea, the trans woman, that she has been gone through a sex reassignment surgery. Then NCC told them that there are many transgender people who have not gone through sex assignment surgery, and including them in a gender-specific field would create a law... privacy, what would we say, privacy, violation of privacy. And they said that allowing transgender would actually, would be like open floodgate in NCC. So what can we say to that? Like, are we supposed to have a different sections for everyone, like trans women, a section for trans women and trans men and transsexuals and different people, or just because right now we just have males and females in trans in NCC.
So tell me, Ananya, in our homes, do we have two toilets for boys and girls, or do we all have only one toilet?
We just have one. Like,
why we have one toilet at home, but outside we expect different toilets?
Well, because I guess privacy. Because I would not
So the whole issue is that we do not respect the other in the public sphere. In the family, we all respect each other, and therefore we will ensure that there is no violation of privacy of every single member in our family. But when it comes to the dealing with the others, if we were respectful, it doesn't matter. The bus, do we have two separate sections that, you know, one side will be all men, one side, your front will be men, one. Certainly, you know, in the metro, we have created no separate sections as such. But these are much more practicality issue, but all these issues are arising because the spaces between the two bodies is not, the distance between two bodies is not maintained in the public sphere. The other's body is not respected. So security, privacy, all these issues are there. But in lots of toilets, you go in the toilets, in the restaurants you go, very rarely you'll find two separate sections. You go to a doctor's clinic, you'll find one. So we have created this ideology of separation. Same was the issue on disability. Should there be a special school for disabled, or they should be integrated? And we said, no, they need to be integrated. The same question was asked about children of the sex workers. Should they be kept separately? In the homes, it's a major issue that if a rescue operation happens and girls from brothels are picked up. So they said, no, these are all exposed girls. They will be defiling the other girls. They should be kept separate. So segregation is always talked about, but it's not useful in mainstreaming. Respect for the other has to be the first value to ingrain, and therefore it doesn't matter. I was in the in my maternal village. They did not have a bathroom to take bath. We are not used to taking bath in the open. So there the culture was that if a woman is taking bath, she'll put a cart, cart with all this. No, so these are made with the strings and all, so it's very see-through in a sense. So they'll say, nahi, humne khaat rakh diya, kya naha lo. And we will feel very exposed. Kaise kaise naha le, isme to sab dikhta hai. But their thing was that if there's a khaat standing, the men will not look at that side. That was the culture. So even if we did not have a closed space for the women to take bath, it was very secure for women to take bath because the culture was very clear that with the cart standing, they will not look that side. In England, we have a statue in Coventry. It's a statue of a princess who is nude riding a horse. So she was protesting against the whatever that money is given to them as a royal. She was saying it's a very less amount. She needs an increase. She was protesting by going nude on the horse. And every single person in the city will not look up when she's going on the horse. But there was one man. He's known as the Peeping Tom. And that's where this phrase has come in. So there was one man who peeped through his window to look at this naked woman. The culture was that if this woman is going, they will not look it up. So even though she was naked, nobody except in that one peeping Tom. But now everybody has become a peeping Tom. So that's what we need to change. Na? You require segregation only as long as you don't respect the other. If you respect the other person has the complete liberty to do what they want to do. All this stalking and voyeurism are all examples of where we do not respect privacy even in their own homes. So that changes. Then you do not require segregation. And incidentally, the opening of positions for women in army, you know what is the real reason? Men are not joining army. There are positions, post after post of officers which are lying vacant because no men want to join army. Sufficient number of men are not joining army. They've got no choice. It's not the empowerment about women's suitability to the position which is resulting into it. There are a lot more other forces which are also playing a part. During World War, because men went to war, all the women were inducted in the West in the job affairs. And it was expected that after the job, they will go back. All the women were paid much less than all the men were getting for the same job. And women thought that because they are being paid less, they will be retained in job. So there are a lot of historical context also because of which certain changes come. So I think it's time for us to stop for today.
Just one more question about public-private dichotomy. You said you will address the doubts in this class.
That was yesterday.
But you said you'll discuss it in today's class.
What is that doubt?
It's not a doubt, it's just an observation. Like when we talk about public and private thing, mm-hmm. We have seen that there are people who are very violative and very bad in their personal life and private sphere, and they are at a very respected place in the public sphere. They do the right judgment. They talk about judges. We are in this field. They do the right judgments. They talk about human rights, women rights, and at the home, they are the ones who are
abusing
domestic violence. And there are very live examples. And as lawyers as well, probably I think that I am a very vocal for women rights, but there might come a case because of my profession, and my profession is to be there for the person, like for the accused or for whatever. So is that make, like, if I become a lawyer and there's a person who comes to me for asking, like, to protect him against a woman who has
filed... Is a rape accused who has come for you as a...
Rape accused has come to me to fight for him. As a professional person, I should do it. Because that is my job. As the lawyers, we are taught that a person is innocent till proven guilty, and that I have been given that duty. But on a personal, I don't want to represent an accused, a rape accused. So how does that? How can I balance that? Because this question generally, it's an ethical question. I can just say no, but it's also my profession. And if I look into my professional ethics, then it is like I should do it.
You know, the same goes for the murder accused as well.
So this is
a professional question, and I think the professional, because it's a fundamental right to have the services of a lawyer, then lawyers ethically cannot refuse. But what they can say is that I will go to this extent, but this is my personal bias also. When you look at Mahatma Gandhi's, truth something, that the title, it will just come.
My experiment with the truth.
So in which he does talk about an incident where he found on examining the paper that his client was in the wrong. There was some miscalculation on the part of his client. So he says that for him, truth and morality were not different. So the professional ethics for him meant truth. So he says, I'm going to tell the judge that we have made a mistake and this is what the true situation is. And the client felt, ke tum to haar jayenge. I said, no, that is up to you, whether you want to hire me or you don't, but this is what I'm going to do. But because the client was an old client and he wanted him to continue for subsequent cases also, so he allowed him to continue. And judge appreciated this fact that, you know, he found as objective, because the lawyers are also friends of the court. So that was one position, one extreme position which Mahatma Gandhi took. A lot of other people say that, and in the criminal law area certainly, the job of the lawyer, defense lawyer, is not to defend his client by telling lies. His job is to find faults in the story of the prosecution. If the prosecution has failed in their job, if they can find faults in the evidence, in the reliability, in the admissibility of the evidence, the investigation is not correct, the lawyer is discharging his professional responsibility zealously. So zealousness does not mean that you will tell lies. It is also not your responsibility to tell the truth to the court. That's also not part of your duty. Your duty as a defense counsel is to find out whether the prosecution has made out a case or not. If you can convince the judge that the prosecution has not discharged its burden, you've done nothing unethical. In Kiran Bedi's case, when she did a raid on the lathi charge on lawyers, the call was given that no lawyer will represent Kiran Bedi. But that is constitutionally wrong. She was entitled to a defense lawyer. So one has to do that balancing, but letting the client know that where you stand. You belong to party A. No, suppose it's a political case. You belong to party A. The candidate has come. The person from the party B has come. And it is not against party A, but it is against party C. You can still say, you know, I'm party A. This is my ideology. So one can take a principal position that I will not take up any case. Stop. But otherwise, you are duty bound. You can only have got two reasons to say no. If there's a conflict of interest, or if you're overworked, you already have too many cases, you will not be able to do justice. Then you can say no to a client. Okay, we'll continue with whatever is still left on Monday. Monday, we are looking at Usha Ramnathan and Ratna Kapoor's articles.
Okay. I'll take me.
Oh, good. Yasheshwar is presenting Ratna. Anybody for Usha Ramnathan?
I have already volunteered for that, so I'll be presenting Usha Ramnathan.
Ananda. Okay, great, great. So 10 minutes each?
Yeah, sure.
So rest time for discussions. Okay, great. Yeah. Thank you. Everybody has marked your attendance?
P-mark me.
Okay, great. See you then Monday.
Thank you, ma'am. Bye-bye.
Everybody else read also. It's not that only the two persons who are presenting will read. Everybody will come prepared and add if they have missed out something. You might have certain more questions.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. Bye-bye. Have a great weekend.